I'm still astounded that the Cardinals got DeAndre Hopkins for a second-round pick and a running back they couldn't wait to unload because he has a $10 million fully guaranteed salary for 2020. We're going to do some props now based upon the new additions that happened last week in the NFL. Let's begin with DeAndre Hopkins and David Johnson. Chris, who will score more touchdowns this year, Hopkins with the Cardinals or Johnson with the Texans?
Okay, well, first off, I just want to comment on what you just were talking about there, just to make one last point. Does the Madden game know that maybe DeAndre Hopkins and his agent were asking for $22 million a year and going to maybe like set the salary cap off kilter for the Texans? Oh, probably doesn't know that, so I don't care.
I don't think the Madden algorithm has advanced to that level yet.
Exactly right. So, okay, so I know it's nice and cool and it didn't work, but this is real life and that was a nice video game moment. I'm going to go with DeAndre Hopkins, though, with more touchdowns. Of course I am. I mean, David Johnson been banged up last year, missed almost all the season the year before. I mean, got hurt in the first game. So DeAndre Hopkins has been one of the go-to best receivers in all of football. And you know he's going to be utilized with Kyler Murray, Cliff Kingsbury. They're going to want to make sure their investment works. I do think David Johnson's going to have better numbers than people are expecting, but I'm still going with DeAndre Hopkins here.
Yeah, I agree with you there. But are you suggesting that the Texans actually got a good deal for DeAndre Hopkins?
I don't think it's as horrible as everybody's tried to make it out to be. I understand. Like, I don't sit here and think, oh, Bill O'Brien got fleeced. I don't look at it like that. No, they got a second-round pick. They got a running back that he obviously valued that still he's looking at. Like, this is a top-end running back in football when healthy. So from that aspect, I think we're like, you know, recent history is making us forget how special of a player David Johnson is, and he hasn't had a lot of wear and tear on his shoulder, on his body the last 2 years. And I think he's going to surprise people to show how talented he still is when he's back with the Texans this year.
And I think one of the points we made last week in the videos that we did when the TV show wasn't on the air, the notion that if you do this deal as the Texans, you've got to be very sensitive to the PR. You've got to get your version of it out there quickly. The reason you're doing this is the guy wants $22 million a year and you have to pay Deshaun Watson and Laremy Tunsil and you can't do it. You can't wait to start leaking that stuff to reporters after things bubble up suggesting there was some sort of a personal issue between DeAndre Hopkins and Bill O'Brien. You've got to get ahead of that. Only Bill Belichick can proceed without worrying about PR because he's got the six pelts on the wall, pellets on the horse, whatever you want to say. The Texans should have gotten it out there that Hopkins wants too much money, and that's why they did the deal. And it would have looked a little bit better to people if they had done that. All right, next up, Todd Gurley, now a member of the Atlanta Falcons. It still seems weird to say that. Over under rush yards for Gurley in 2020, 1,000. Chris, what do you have?
I'm going to go over for two reasons. One, I think the Atlanta Falcons realize that, you know, hey, they're trying to improve their offensive line. We saw that in the draft last year. They're going to be a little more focused on their run game. But, you know, two things here. Todd Gurley, I think, is going to look at it and go, okay, I got to start proving to people that I'm healthy here. It's still a go-to guy to give the ball to. So I think he'll go all out and maybe push the limits of his knee a little bit. And then the Atlanta Falcons, who know, oh, we might only have him for a year. You know, I don't know if they're necessarily going to care about his long-term future as a player either. So I think he's going to get a lot of work this year. I'm going to go for over 1,000 yards. Plus that little added bonus of you want to stick it up your old team's butt and show them that you're still ready to go and still a really good player, which I think Gurley will want to do to the Rams.
He had a career-low 223 rushing attempts last year, career-low 857 yards, but not far from 1,000, and I think they were deliberately being careful with him last year because of that knee. And one last point about his contract. I crunched the numbers over the weekend. The Rams did not have to give Todd Gurley a second contract. He has 5 years in. They could have treated him exactly the way the Chargers treated Melvin Gordon. You finish your rookie contract, we pick up the fifth-year option, and then you become a free agent. If the Rams had done that to Todd Gurley, he would have made about $23.5 million over 5 years. With the contract that he did in 2018 after his third season, Chris, he made $46 million in 5 years from the Rams, and he's in the same spot he would have been in if they hadn't given him a second contract. He walks away as a free agent. So remember that when you try to suggest that Todd Gurley in some way lost. He won big time, Chris.
No, he did. And you know, I'm never going to be mad at it. He's put his body on the line since his college years at Georgia. And, you know, that's $23 million in Todd Gurley's pocket and $23 million out of Stan Kroenke's pocket. I like the money better in Gurley's pocket. Kroenke's got enough to go around. So I'm not going to be sitting here complaining about it.
One of the reasons for teams to be leery about giving big money to running backs is because it seems like when so many do, the running back ends up not being able to perform or not willing to perform or whatever the case may be. We rarely see a guy live up to it. Melvin Gordon becomes a free agent. He gets a 2-year, $16 million deal with the Chargers, less than what the Chargers were willing to give him last year when he held out. In Denver is where he will now be. Over under on touchdowns for Melvin Gordon in 2020, 10 and a half. What do you have, Chris?
I'm going to go under there. You know, 10 and a half, when you start scoring double-digit touchdowns, I mean, you're having a top-tier type of season at the running back position. I mean, two things. You know, the Denver Broncos got a lot of talented weapons on their team right now. And, you know, with Drew Lock and Noah Fant and Sutton, Courtland Sutton at receiver, plus the Philip Lindsay factor. I think he's going to take away some of the touchdowns of a Melvin Gordon. So he might get close to it, but I'm going under 10 and a half.
He had 9 last year, Gordon did, in 12 games with the Chargers. So I'm going to go over.
I
I'm going to
know.
go over.
All
I
right.
think they're going to feel compelled to justify the investment. And I actually think that this is bad news for Philip Lindsay. We had him at the Super Bowl after his rookie season. Not a big guy, not a thick guy. And I think he's having a hard time dealing with that pounding and the pounding and the pounding that
Sure.
you take at the NFL level as a running back. And I think, to me, the decision to make that kind of investment in Melvin Gordon suggests that Philip Lindsay is not going to get big money from the Denver Broncos, and he may see his role diminish this year, which makes me even more convinced Gordon is going to get more than 10 and a half touchdowns. All right,
Well,
Stephon Diggs.
Mike, yeah, but you're
Go
right.
ahead.
But you're right though, Mike, there, because I mean, Philip Lindsay, you're right, not a big guy, so they got to save him. They can't have him being the bell cow between the tackles type runner that way. And this really, Philip Lindsay, he should welcome it. It's going to extend his career. It really is. It's going to make him a better player 3 and 4 years from now. And he'll still have explosive and quick explosive, you know, ness and quickness in his body to where he's not beat to crap here. So this is going to be a good thing for him ultimately.
You know, it's funny though. That trend has been around for about 15 years now. From time to time, I'll ask running backs, do you prefer to be used on a more limited basis so you can extend your career? And they still all want to be the guy. They all want to have 25 carries a game. They all want to have that experience in the fourth quarter where they feel like the defense is worn down and they're getting more yardage, especially the bigger guys. They're pounding and pounding and pounding. A Derrick Henry wants that 30 carries a game because he knows he gets better as the game goes on. All right, Stephon Diggs in Buffalo. Over under receiving yards, 1,200. He's never had 1,200 in a season. Will he go over that in his first season with the Bills?
I can't give him over 1,200. You know, I do think he's going to dance and flirt with this a little bit. I think he goes over 1,000 yards, definitely. Yes. But, you know, I think with Devin Singletary still a tailback up there, he'll have more of a role in the pass game. Dawson Knox, the tight end they drafted at Ole Miss last year, I think he'll get more and more touches in this. And then don't forget Cole Beasley and John Brown. So Diggs, the go-to guy, but I think the beauty of Diggs being here in Buffalo is a little bit like we've seen in New England the last 20 years. Yeah, he'll be the go-to guy, but they're not going to be so obsessive that, you know, they're going to cancel out other people within their offense. I think this will be a lot of people will touch the ball, and Cole Beasley and John Brown will still be a big part of it.
Yeah, I agree with you. And I don't think they brought Diggs in to have 1,200 plus receiving yards. He's a guy who can be a game breaker. He can run all the routes and he will get the ball, but not to the extent that he's going to have a career high in receiving yards. But he makes that offense better. And we've got that vacuum now with the Patriots losing Tom Brady and several other free agents. There's an opportunity. We talked about it before free agency, an opportunity for another team in that division to rise up. And I think you and I both would agree that right now, even though the Dolphins have added 10 free agents from other teams, it feels like the Bills are in position to make that move, the bold move. They gave up a lot more than what the Cardinals gave up to get DeAndre Hopkins. And the Bills need Stephon Diggs to make an impact. You know, I remember last week when that trade first came out, Chris, I thought, well, it's sad to see him leave the Vikings. But when you look at what they got, it's like, well, you know, they kind of made him an offer they can't refuse.
Well, yeah, they did. But, also, again, we can't go apples to apples, DeAndre Hopkins, Stephon Diggs. I mean, again, the contract conversation matters. Stephon Diggs, there's great value in the fact that he signed up for what, at least 3 more years at $12 million a season, basically. I mean, that's nothing for a top-tier wide receiver. Plus, Mike, I'm not going to sit here and go, oh my gosh, they got fifth and a sixth-round pick. Oh man, they fleeced them. I mean, fifth and sixth round picks, yes, they make football teams, sure, but not many of our stars in our league are from those rounds. I know Tom Brady is, but you're limited in that. Other than that, what do you want to say? Go ahead.
They got a one, they got a five, they got a six, and a four next year. And don't assume Stephon Diggs is going to be content to play out the balance of his contract. I think that's one of the factors as well. And I think he is going to want a new deal from the Buffalo Bills. And if he doesn't get one, we will periodically see the pouty Stephon Diggs. I mean, the Bills have made the investment by way of trade compensation, and they get everything that goes along with it, the good and the bad. And the Vikings did a good job of keeping the bad under wraps for the most part. I know a lot of receivers are this way, but he's going to want to get paid, especially if Hopkins gets $22 million. It's very easy for him to say, well, they didn't give up anything for DeAndre Hopkins in Arizona. Look at all the money they're paying him. The Bills give up first-round pick for me. They should pay me. They should pay me. I want more. I want more. And I'm not saying he shouldn't. I'm just saying don't assume he's going to be content with that contract. He's going to want more money sooner rather than later. All right, Emmanuel Sanders, available in free agency. Surprise signing by the Saints. One of those things where we should have seen it coming and how beautiful of a move it is. You put him with Michael Thomas, over under 900 receiving yards for Emmanuel Sanders with Thomas across from him and Drew Brees throwing the football.
I'm going to go under here. I think Alvin Kamara's health was not 100% last year. I think he'll have a better role in the offense. Let's not forget about Jared Cook. He was banged up a ton last year as well. So, having said those names right there, as long as they're healthy, they're going to take away a lot of production from a guy like Emmanuel Sanders. So Emmanuel Sanders, I think, is a great fit there. But I think ultimately, no, I think he's somewhere around the 700-yard mark because, as long as Kamara's healthy, they're going to feed him the ball, Jared Cook as well. And I would think another receiver arises from that group as well.
He had 869 yards last year in 17 games between two teams, the Broncos and the 49ers. The year before that, 868 in 12 games with the Broncos before he tore an Achilles tendon. I'm going to go over because I think that when defenses have that full offseason to take a closer look at what Michael Thomas did last year, they may come up with ways to deliberately take him away like the Vikings did in the playoff victory in New Orleans, and it'll open things up for Emmanuel Sanders. And I think we're going to see him have kind of a renaissance year. He hasn't had a great high-end quarterback since Peyton Manning, and now he's got one in Drew Brees.
Hi, I'm Mike Tirico, and thanks for watching. Make sure to hit subscribe for the latest news and highlights from NBC Sports.